What we're going to do is we're going to look at a passage here in Acts chapter 15. It was absolutely coincidental that this past Friday I received an email, and in addition, we had our Friday night Zoom fellowship, and during the after discussion, after Brother Des Stridham taught his lesson, there's always a little bit of discussion and questions and so forth, and interestingly enough, there was a lady from Northern Ireland, it just so happens to be, that was asking about Acts chapter 15, verse 7. And at the same day, I received an email from a brother who actually is in Wyoming, and he was sharing with me some things that have been happening in his circle of friends and family. And what's been happening is, he is being shunned by very close friends. He has come to understand right division. He is just taking a very firm stand on dispensational Bible truth. And as he is sharing what he is learning about dispensationalism, he's so excited about it. Some of you can relate. You discover the key of right division, and then God's word just makes sense. It opens up. And it's just a wonderful thing. Well, in his zeal, by sharing what he's learning, close friends and family now are shunning him. And he received an email from an individual who was challenging what he is now believing. And interestingly enough, one of the arguments that this person who was rabidly anti-dispensational, he used Acts chapter 15, verse 7 to try to, quote, prove that Peter was the first one who was out there preaching among the Gentiles and so on and so forth. So, again, it was just a coincidence. Maybe it was a sign that I'll look at it, okay? I'm just kidding when I say that, all right? But let's read Acts chapter 15 and notice verse 7. And when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, Men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago God made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. Our Father, once again, we do thank you for your grace, your love, your goodness. And as we come to your word with humble hearts and a desire to have greater understanding regarding the outworking of your purposes, whether it's your purpose on the earth vested in and through the nation of Israel, or whether it's your purpose vested in the heavenly places and what it is you're doing today, the formation of the church, the body of Christ. As always, may we have a clearer understanding, a more accurate understanding regarding what it is you're doing. And as we approach this passage of Scripture, may we have a better grasp of what it is Peter here is communicating to his Jewish audience. As always, may our time together prove to be profitable and edifying. And of course, we ask in Christ Jesus' name and for his sake. For those of you who may not be all that familiar with dispensationalism, and by the way, it's good to have a guest out here, what we recognize is that God's word is not intended to just be read as any ordinary piece of literature. If we were to ask, where should one begin studying the Bible, don't begin in the book of Genesis, don't begin in the book of Matthew, and some would even say you're supposed to begin in the book of John. And what we recognize, 2 Timothy 2:15, is that we study to show ourselves approved unto God, workmen that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Fundamentally, what that means is we recognize that God in time, God in human history, has not dealt with just one group of people carrying out one singular purpose. What we recognize when we rightly divide the word of truth, there are different ways in which God is dealing with humanity. There are different periods of time in which God is dealing with humanity. We recognize time past, but now ages to come. With all of that said, what we also recognize when we rightly divide the word of truth is that there are different programs. There are different gospels. And I want to preface what we will be doing this evening, because we recognize, for example, very quickly, if you turn to Romans chapter 16, okay, Romans chapter 16, we, of course, emphasize the unique gospel that the Apostle Paul was entrusted with. We recognize that God has given to the Apostle Paul a very specific, very singular body of information. And we recognize that it is unique and distinct, okay? So when we come across the term gospel, we recognize there is a specific system of information that God has given to His people, the church, the body of Christ, in this current dispensation called the dispensation of the grace of God, a dispensation which was kept hidden since the world began. So if we read, for example, Romans chapter 16, and this is just one verse in this regard, verse 25, "Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began." Notice, Paul makes a reference to my gospel. A number of times, Paul is going to defend and highlight the unique gospel message that was entrusted to him and by extension given to us as well. With that said, the church at large has made a huge mistake in assuming that every time you run across the word gospel, it means the same thing, that it is a reference to one gospel. And that just is not the case. Paul, here in Romans 16, verse 25, he, of course, makes a reference to my gospel. We recognize, at minimum, a number of different gospels. We certainly recognize the gospel of the kingdom. We recognize the gospel of the circumcision, the gospel of the uncircumcision, the gospel of God, the gospel of Christ, the gospel of grace. Those terms are extremely important. When the Bible talks about these various gospels, it's not talking about one specific gospel. It's talking about different systems of information. And so the reason I want to preface what we will be doing for the remainder of our study, let's go back to Acts chapter 15. We recognize that the Apostle Paul was raised up, called, converted, commissioned in Acts chapter 9, the historic point in Scripture, the point in history where we find a change taking place dispensationally, a departure and break from God's prophetic purpose with and through the nation of Israel, and now the revelation and formation of a new organism, a new entity called the Church, the Body of Christ, two different people with two different purposes, two different destinies, two different hopes, so on and so forth. What we understand when we rightly divide the word of truth, the change takes place in history as recorded in Acts chapter 9. And from that point on, the Apostle Paul is given progressive revelation. God didn't deposit the entire mystery system, the entire revelation, the entire package of information at one time. God, over time, began to reveal progressive information to the Apostle Paul. And that's when we discover that to the Apostle Paul, there is this unique gospel. When we say that, we also recognize that Paul's gospel is not the same as some of the other gospels. When Paul talks about the gospel of grace, that is not the same as the gospel of the kingdom. When Paul talks about the gospel of the uncircumcision, that is not the same as the gospel of the circumcision. You've got uncircumcision, you've got circumcision, you've got grace, you've got the kingdom, so on and so forth. People who reject the biblically mandated system of right division, the way God wants his book to be studied, it's by rightly dividing the word of truth. People who reject it, they try to homogenize, they try to harmonize all of these different gospels. And I remember years ago, we had a Bible study in Aurora, and we actually looked at 10 different gospels, and we had a visitor, and this guy, his eyeballs just popped out of his head. He was shocked. He could not believe that we, as a ministry here, and I, as a teacher in that particular, at that particular time, believe that there are differences. He was adamant. They're all the same thing. Well, if words have meaning, but regardless, so when we distinguish these different gospels and we say that in the current dispensation of grace, there is a unique gospel that was entrusted to the Apostle Paul, what do you do with Acts chapter 15? So we read Acts chapter 15, verse 7 again. And when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, Men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago, a minimum of 14 years, by the way, okay? When Peter says, this was a while back, all right? And I'll refer to my little timeline here in just a second. You know how that a good while ago, God made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel. When we recognize right division, we recognize that Peter was never sent to the Gentiles. And we're eventually going to get to Acts chapter two, Galatians chapter 2. We read there in Galatians chapter 2 that this system of revelation called the gospel of the circumcision was specifically entrusted to Peter. Peter, throughout his whole Acts period, is addressing the nation of Israel. That's why it's called the gospel of the circumcision. It has everything to do with Israel. So, and then as we continue on, we learn that to Paul was given the gospel of the uncircumcision, the gospel of grace, the gospel of Christ, and so forth. And that's distinct. It's different than Peter. Peter was never raised up to go directly to the Gentiles. Paul is the one who calls himself the apostle of the Gentiles, okay? And as the apostle of the Gentiles, Paul was given the gospel of grace. He was given the gospel of the uncircumcision. Well, if God didn't send Peter with the gospel to the Gentiles, but he did send Paul with a gospel to the Gentiles, then how can Peter say that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel? People who are antagonistic, people who reject right division, they attempt to use verse 7 as a proof text, proving, supposedly, Peter launched a ministry to the Gentiles. Peter preached the gospel to the Gentiles. And yet there's only one individual that we will identify as ever being preached to by Peter. So we'll look at that. And then one other verse, drop down to verse 14. Now this is James speaking. Verse 14, Simeon hath declared how God at the first, by the way, he's talking about Peter, okay? Simeon, Peter. Simeon hath declared how God at the first did visit the Gentiles. You see, verse 14 proves that Peter was the first to go to the Gentiles. Peter was the first, we already read verse 7, who is now preaching a gospel or the gospel to the Gentiles. So the argument is we're wrong. We cannot maintain our argument that Peter was restricted to the circumcision, to the nation of Israel. Paul, however, had a distinct ministry restricted to the Gentiles at large, so on and so forth, okay? And that's the controversy. And as I mentioned on Friday, it was just coincidental, the email and then the dear lady during the Zoom meeting who was asking, because they're both being shunned. They're both being challenged. They're both losing family. They're losing friends because they maintain this understanding of dispensationalism, and their good, supposed good friends and family, they're shunning these two people, okay? How do we now answer what is it that Peter did? Let's go back to verse 7 again, right? Acts chapter 15, verse 7. And when Peter had been, and when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago. First thing we want to point out is when Peter here in Acts chapter 15 makes a reference to a while ago, he's making a reference to something that is going to happen in Acts, recorded in Acts chapter 10. However, it's happening in Acts chapter 9. I don't want to confuse anybody right now, okay? What's Acts chapter 9 and chapter 10 are occurring simultaneously in time. Yes, you read scripture. Always remember that God's teaching techniques, there is time compression, for example. You have chapters that will provide what is called subsequent narrative. It actually will provide a narrative about what has previously taken place. So those are little things that we do want to be mindful of. When we read Acts chapter 10, we want to be mindful that it's a record of what God is doing with Peter, but it's actually taking place in Acts chapter 9. What is significant about Acts chapter 9? The road to Damascus, something radical happens, something that should not have happened according to prophecy occurs when Jesus appears to the, well, Saul, we call him Paul now, and begins something brand new, a departure, a clear departure from the prophetic system that was known, preached, taught since the world began. We already read Romans chapter 16, verse 25. Paul's talking about a system of information that was kept secret since the world began. You can't have something secret and something spoken taking place or occurring at the same time. It defies all logic. So prophetically, there's information that God revealed progressively to and through the prophets since the world began, knowable, recorded in Scripture. And then Paul says, you know what God did with me? He revealed a system of information that God himself kept secret since the world began. There is no Scripture you can go to learn about what God now is revealing to and through the Apostle Paul. It isn't until we read Romans through Philemon we get all of the glorious details, okay? So if we can kind of envision this little timeline, if you will, the historic point where God now is going to depart from his prophetic purposes and focus on the Gentiles to usher in a what the Bible calls a mystery purpose occurs in Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 10 is going to explain what is happening with Peter during Acts chapter 9. Acts chapter 11 is going to explain why Peter did what he did as recorded in Acts chapter 10. All right, it shouldn't be that complicated. So that's why I put Acts 9 and then 10 and 11 together. And then 14 years later, minimum, we could say 17 years, but just to keep things simple, because Paul does say something about a three-year period of time in Galatians chapter 1, and then 14 years after that, Galatians chapter 2. So I'm not going to argue. If you want to say 17 years, it's not a problem, okay? It's not a problem. But at minimum, 14 years later, we're now here in Acts chapter 15. And now Peter's going to explain what happened 14 years earlier in Acts chapter 10. And now we find this language, the end of verse 7, how that God made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth, by the way, no other apostle, Jesus never launched an apostolic ministry or an apostolic evangelistic crusade to the Gentiles in Acts chapters 1 through 7. It just is not there. Israel, 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 Israel. So Peter says, by my mouth, something happened 14 years earlier at the end of verse 7, that by my mouth, the Gentiles should hear the word of the gospel. And now people get all excited here, right? The gospel. First of all, does it tell us what gospel Peter's referring to? That, number one, let's just, I'm not you people, settle down a little bit. Number one, what gospel is he talking about? So everybody, well, it's the gospel. Okay, what do you mean? The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Well, kind of interesting. We don't have that kind of information going back there to Acts chapter 10. Kind of interesting. So the assumption among evangelicalism, the assumption among the church at large, the assumption among fundamentalists is that when you come across the word gospel, what does it mean? It's the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ who died for all of our sins. That is the assumption that is always being made and yet unsupported. The gospel of the kingdom. Wait a minute. Jesus preached the gospel of the kingdom. He prepared his disciples for his crucifixion, but he didn't preach his death, burial, and resurrection as good news for the sins of all humanity. Well, what about John 3:16? Where's the blood in John 3:16? So what I'm getting at, I don't mean to rabbit trail here, but wait a minute. Just because Peter makes a reference to the gospel, a great mistake happens. It's like the word salvation in the Bible. When you come across the word salvation in the Bible, does it always mean by default salvation unto eternal life, having your sins forgiven? No. The word salvation is used many different ways. There's all types of different salvations in the Bible, okay? So the word baptism, does baptism always refer to water? Absolutely not. There's different types of baptisms. In fact, the majority of the baptisms found in the Bible are dry, doesn't entail H2O. The word justification doesn't always mean imputed righteousness. Justification can mean different things. So what's the point? When we read the term, the language, the word of the gospel, don't make the mistake that the church at large usually makes. Oh, he's talking about how to have eternal life, have all your sins forgiven, and how to get to heaven because you rest in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Go over to Romans chapter 10. The word gospel, okay? The word gospel in and of itself, you can break it down, the etymology, real easy. Go, spell, okay? That would be a real easy way of defining gospel. You see, go, spell. What does the G-O stand for? It can stand for one of two things. Okay, go, spell. What is spell? When we talk about spelling, we're talking about words, right? Go, spell. Good, spell. Good, word. God, spell. God, word. The word gospel simply means, by definition, some good information, some good news, some good tidings, a good word, God's word, okay? Fundamentally, that's what the word gospel means. There are different types of good news. There are different systems of God's word, good tidings. It all depends on what? The context, okay? Romans chapter 10, kind of an interesting verse, and verse 15. And how, Romans 10:15, and how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace. But keep reading. And bring glad tidings of what? Good things. Now, you know what a glad tiding is? Good news. Here we go again. It's just another form of the word gospel. We can prove that in Luke chapter 8. We're not going to do that, but glad tidings of the kingdom in Luke chapter 8. That's the gospel of the kingdom. So you can substitute the word gospel with the words good tidings. It means the same thing, okay? But the point here in verse 15, you know what gospel means, and gospel can be used to bring glad tidings of what? Good things. There's some good news. God has some good news. And it isn't restricted to just one singular set of good news. We, knee-jerk reaction, well, it's always death, burial, and resurrection. Always death, burial, and resurrection. Always death, burial, and resurrection. Well, that's not being honest. But God, He enjoys communicating glad tidings. Go to Isaiah, which, by the way, comes from Isaiah chapter 52. But notice in Isaiah chapter 52 and what we read at verse 7. God enjoys communicating good news. You know, God's a happy God. He's the blessed God, right? And so when the Lord has good stuff to communicate, He rejoices. He likes communicating good things. Isaiah chapter 52, verse 7, from which Romans 10, verse 15 is quoted. Verse 7, how beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of Him. By the way, context is Christ, but we're not looking at that. That bringeth good tidings, that publishes peace. That bringeth good tidings of good, that publishes salvation. That saith unto Zion, thy God reigneth. My point is this. You know what gospel means? Communicating good tidings. Good tidings of good. I love that. Bringeth good tidings, that is good news, of what? Of good. So the word gospel can be used in a very general sense, unless the context demands that it be applied to a very specific sense. When Peter's talking about the Gentiles hearing the word of the gospel, Peter did communicate some good things to a Gentile. I should say Gentiles, because that included Cornelius' household, okay? So we don't have to demand Peter's talking about the death, burial, and resurrection, or Peter's talking about the same gospel that Paul's talking about. Peter's talking about the gospel of grace. Peter's talking about the gospel of the circumcision. No, what Peter is saying, you know, the Gentiles, they got some pretty good information that I communicated to them. General, we don't need to demand specificity. But see, that's what the church does. It demands specificity. We got to nail down the specific. Peter's just saying, I got some good news, okay? Now, with that said, before we go any further, in fact, let's go back to Acts chapter 15. I just want to point some things out in the passage before we examine, well, what was it that Peter communicated that he says, man, this is good news. This is the gospel. Go back to Acts chapter 15, and let me just finish referring to this little timeline here, okay? So again, the historic point in which there is a dispensational change taking place, Acts chapter 9, and then we're going to find out what God is going to be doing with Peter at the same time in Acts chapter 10. Chapter 11 is going to amplify why Peter's doing what he did in Acts 10. Then 14 years later, fast forward, you get to Acts chapter 15. And here's the key. Paul, the apostle of the Gentiles, to whom was entrusted the specific system of information called grace, called Christ, the death, burial, and resurrection, called uncircumcision, Paul is going to supply his narrative, his official certified record of what transpired in Acts chapter 15. Here's something that we want to take note of. Should we go to Peter to learn how to understand Acts chapter 15, or should we go to Paul to understand what happened in Acts chapter 15? Who do you go to and why? First of all, Peter's not our apostle. Peter was never sent to the Gentiles. In fact, Peter clearly was given the good news of the circumcision. He, Peter, restricted his ministry to the nation of Israel. Peter, he writes to the scattered tribes of Israel. So here's my point in saying what I'm saying here. If I want to know what's going on in Acts 15, do I, as a Gentile, year 2024, go to Peter to provide to me an explanation, someone who was never sent to minister to the Gentiles? Or would I go to the guy who consistently, continually says, I'm the apostle of the Gentiles? It's quite obvious we go to the one whom God sent to educate us, the Apostle Paul. My point is this: to truly appreciate what's happening in Acts 15, whether it's Peter or whether it's James or whether it's Paul, we go to Paul's narrative and account that is certified, Galatians chapter 2, and then we're going to learn something. For anyone who demands that what Peter is referring to in Acts chapter 15, verse 7, when by his mouth the Gentiles hear the gospel, if they demand it's the same information that Paul's going to refer to in the book of Galatians, they are absolutely wrong. There is no way you can even begin to argue that Peter's message is no different than Paul. It is an absolute impossibility. Now, church tradition will sort of force, you know, the square peg into the round hole, and they'll dance around it, but you can't do that, okay? One other point, because of, I'm afraid we're not going to get there, but drop down to verse 14 again. Now be careful with verse 14. This is James, okay? And James now, he's an authority there at the church there in Jerusalem, the Jewish church in Jerusalem, okay? And always remember, the book of Acts is written specifically to the nation of Israel to provide an explanation as to why God has the right to do what he's doing in Acts chapter 9. God has a right to do that. God changes the program? Absolutely. He's God. He's the potter. Okay? Israel's the clay. And so Acts is an historic record of God's right to suspend his dealings with the nation of Israel, suspend the prophetic program, and do something that he has never done before. But we don't read Acts through the lens of a Gentile trying to understand the workings of God within the church, the body of Christ, and how it is. You got to read the book of Acts through the lens of an Israelite, of a Jew. And then Acts is going to make a whole lot more sense. Verse 14, Simeon hath declared how God at the first did visit the Gentiles to take out of them a people. See? So the critic, oh, there we go again. Even James is going to reaffirm Peter's ministry. Peter, he's the first guy to visit the Gentiles. Be careful, because that's not what the verse says. It's easy to read. Notice, Simeon hath declared how God at the first did visit the Gentiles. It does not say Peter is first to declare something to the Gentiles. Did you notice that? Rather, Peter has declared how that God is doing something for the first time among the Gentiles. There's a big difference. Peter isn't saying, I'm the first that is sent to the Gentiles. I'm the first that God is using to launch this ministry to and among the Gentiles. Peter is not saying, I'm the first one to initiate an evangelistic campaign among the Gentiles. What he is saying is, or James is saying about Peter is, Peter, he's going to declare that God is doing something for the first time among the Gentiles. There's a real difference there. And what is it that James says? For the first time, by the way, God does use Peter to communicate to this Cornelius, we'll get there in just a minute, I'm doing something for the very first time. That's not the same as Peter being the first. Well, what is it that God's doing for the very first time among the Gentiles? Read verse 14 again. How God at the first did visit the Gentiles. You see the word visit? You know what God's doing for the first... By the way, who are the people of God historically in the Bible? Israel. God says, I'm going to dwell among them. God says, they're my people. God says, I will be their God. They will be my people. Going all the way back to Genesis chapter 12, God isolates the nation of Israel and God says, they're mine and no other nation belongs to me. Israel, my people, okay? But the God who says, I'm going to dwell among them, God says, my sanctuary is there. My glory is there. The ark is there. I am going to dwell in the midst of Israel. But there's a difference between living, dwelling, a domicile, being at home, and visiting the who. You just notice the wording. God says, I'm going to go visit somebody. Now, if you're visiting somebody, what does that also imply? Look at verse 15. And to this agree the words of the prophets, as it is written, after this, I will what? Return. Who was I talking to this morning about traveling overseas? And, we traveled to Singapore, Philippines, and India. We're talking about airplanes, okay? And when we landed in India, and we were puddle jumping a little bit, and I remember we were boarding this one aircraft, and I'm a little nervous. It looked a little rough, and we walked into the cabin. Man, there was duct tape everywhere, and I'm thinking, I don't know if I want to go. I'm ready to jump out. The flight was fine. Okay. With that said, after 5 weeks. It was November, December, and it was interesting. The last few days in India, it was like, I want to go home. I want to come back to Chicago. I miss my family. I miss my wife. I miss the kids. And I was starting, I was getting a little antsy. We were all getting antsy. Me and Tracy and Dan, we were kind of getting at it. We're starting to kind of get a little, So you know what? I enjoyed the folks there in Singapore. I enjoyed the Philippine people. They're beautiful people, wonderful, wonderful people. India, they were good people too. The food was fantastic, and so forth. But you know what? I want to go home. It's a visit for me. It was like a five-week visit. That's not my home. My home. I had a passport. My address. My home. My family. My allegiance. My loyalty. My love. My affection. It was home. Chicago, my wife, my kids, there on Pontiac Avenue, But I returned home. You know what Simeon is saying? God, for the first time, who dwelt among Israel, exclusively his peculiar people. They're my God, my people, I'm their God. For the first time, God says, you know what? I'm gonna leave you guys for a while. I'm gonna pay a visit to the who? The Gentiles. Where in prophecy does God ever say, I'm gonna leave home for a while? And I'm gonna take a journey. By the way, you know how long God has been visiting with the Gentiles now? 2,000 years. But that's okay. I get antsy after 5 weeks. God, he hasn't been home with Israel for over 2,000 years. But with that said, verse 15, is he going to return? I'm sorry, verse 16. After this, I will what? Return. So here's what I'm getting at. Simon, James, when he talks about Simeon, what he's saying is, Simeon, Peter is the one to whom God is going to declare to the nation of Israel, hey, nation of Israel, I'm going to leave. and I'm going to visit Gentiles. Unheard of, uncharacteristic. That is a break from what God promised to do. You know what God promised to do to the Gentiles? I'm going to destroy them all. If they don't comply, if the Gentiles don't comply, if the Gentiles don't participate in what it is that I am doing, God says, I'll destroy them all. But now God is saying, I'm going to leave the house. I'm going to leave home. And I'm going to pay a visit to the Gentiles. That is a clear that is a reference to God's dispensational dealings with the Gentiles. And then I'll come back home where I belong, where my heart is, where my allegiance is, where my, you know, where my family is, okay? So just be careful with verse 14. It is oftentimes misread to suggest that Peter's the first one to declare something to the Gentiles. No, Peter's the one who declares God's doing something for the first time, okay? With all of that said, what is Peter talking about? Quickly, let's go to Acts chapter 10. Okay, now remember, Peter says, a while ago. And it's kind of interesting. In the record, it isn't until 14 years later, minimum. You can say 17. I'm not going to argue with you, but at minimum. It isn't until 14 years later that Peter now expresses an understanding of what happened 14 years earlier. And what happened in Acts 15 that triggered Peter to understand what is going on dispensationally. Never miss the key in understanding Acts 15 is Paul personally met with him. That's the key. So it isn't until Acts 15 you find Peter talking about Gentiles, suggesting God's paying them a visit, but he's going to come back home one day. Now, we know it's been over 2,000 years, okay? Isn't it interesting? It isn't until he meets Paul that Peter now says some things in Acts 15, which, by the way, we're going to see in just a second, the language that he's using is consistent with what Paul taught Peter, not the other way around. The church has it absolutely backwards, okay? That Paul, you know, he's just a continuation of Peter's ministry. Paul is just preaching the same thing that Peter is preaching. That Paul, he's doing what Peter was doing among the Jews. Paul's just doing it to the Gentiles, so on and so forth. And the thinking is that Paul is some sort of natural extension of Peter's. And no, what Galatians 2 is going to say, Peter didn't know, he didn't add anything to my understanding. Vice versa. I'm the one that's educating Peter. And by the way, we give Peter absolute total credit in Galatians chapter 2 because Paul says Peter got it. And now Peter's going to use language in Acts 15 that you don't find Peter using before Acts 15. My point is this. Peter's now using Pauline language. Why? Why is Peter using Pauline language in Acts 15? 14 years later. Because Paul is educating him. By the way, kudos to Peter. Peter wasn't some narcissistic, arrogant, proudful character who said, how dare this guy show me anything. You got to give Peter credit. Peter saw what was going on, and he humbly received Paul's ministry as being unique, separate, and distinct. Peter didn't run around thinking, what a threat to me, what a threat to my ministry, what a threat to the... You know what, Peter? Peter has some good things to say about Paul, by the way, right? 2 Peter chapter 3. So anyway, go to Acts chapter 10. So when we go to Acts chapter 10, this is what Peter... By the way, Acts 10, this is good news if you're a Gentile. Remember, good news, gospel in a general sense. These are glad tidings. This is exciting stuff. For the Gentiles, something's changing here. Now, Peter, he's struggling. You read Acts chapter 10, and it's the whole encounter that he has with Cornelius. There are, by the way, four accounts of this encounter. You read Acts chapter 10 and Acts chapter 11, those two chapters revolve around Peter's meeting with Cornelius. Why are there two chapters dedicated to this meeting between Peter and Cornelius? Why are there four accounts of the meeting? Does that kind of suggest it's pretty important? I mean, why else would God have to give so many accounts? It's critically important for Israel to understand, hey, Israel, I'm going to pay a visit to those time-past uncircumcised Gentiles that prophetically aren't really worthy and prophetically deserve to suffer some wrath and so on and so forth. So we're in Acts chapter 10. We begin at verse 1. We're not going to read the whole chapter, so don't get nervous or anything. But just real quickly, Acts chapter 10, verse 1. There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius, a centurion of the band called the Italian band. Now, immediately, you got to think about another centurion. Because what's going to happen with this centurion is parallel to what happened to another centurion during Messiah's ministry. My point is this: whatever is going to happen in Acts chapter 10 is not really different. And I want to be a little careful here. It's almost identical to an encounter that Jesus Christ as Israel's Messiah has with the centurion. Isn't that interesting? Because you'll hear people argue, well, you know, this Cornelius, he is a pattern for Gentiles in the dispensation of the grace of God. What a horrible pattern. If Cornelius is a pattern for a Gentile to become a member of the body of Christ in the dispensation of grace, we're in big, big trouble, okay? Because he is not a pattern for salvation unto eternal life in the dispensation of grace. I am so sorry. That is just not what's going on in Acts chapter 10. But what is happening in Acts chapter 10 parallels, it's almost a mirror reflection of something that happens in Luke chapter 7, which we'll read in just a second. What is it about this guy? Verse 2, a devout man and one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people. And you know who the people are, right? What did Moses say to Pharaoh? What did God say? Let my people go. So you know what we know about this Gentile, the centurion? This guy, he's devout. He feared God with all his house, and he gave much alms to the people and prayed to God always. Are those the prerequisites? Are those the requirements to get eternal life? No. So wait a minute. How can some suggest, what a beautiful pattern, God's reaching out to the Gentiles? Drop down to verse 22. And they said, Cornelius the centurion, a just man and one that feareth God and of good report among all the nation of the Jews. Wait a minute. Go to Luke chapter 7. Go to Luke chapter 7. And it's just really fascinating when, if you compare the centurion in the book of Acts to the centurion that Jesus deals with in Luke chapter 7. And the reason I want to do this is, real quick, to whom did Jesus say he was sent? Remember what Jesus said to his 12 disciples? He said, listen, gentlemen, Matthew chapter 10, right? Enter ye not into the ways of the Gentile, right? Enter ye not into the way of the Gentiles. Why? Because I am not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of who? Israel. Jesus never directly ministered. He never took the initiative to minister to a Gentile. He responded to two Gentiles that came to him. And you remember the Syrophoenician woman. Jesus wouldn't even talk to this woman. And even when this poor, you understand the story. Here's my point. Jesus when he said, I am not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, he backed it up. He didn't go to the Gentiles. And he clearly forbade his disciples, don't you even go into the way of the Gentiles. That's not what I'm all about. That's not what you're all about. But interestingly enough, here is a Gentile. Here is an exception. There are a couple of exceptions, all right? The two big exceptions, this centurion and the Syrophoenician woman. Luke chapter 7, verse 2, and a certain centurion's servant who was dear unto him was sick and ready to die, right? And when he heard of Jesus, look what this guy does. He sent unto him the elders of the Jews, beseeching him that he would come and heal his servant. And when they came to Jesus, they besought him and instantly saying that he was worthy for whom he should do this. Why? Why is this Gentile worthy? Verse 5, for he loveth our nation and he hath built us a synagogue. Is that the pattern for Gentile salvation in the dispensation of the grace of God today? No. So you have these two centurions, which, by the way, it's pretty admirable. Jesus can't even find that kind of love, dedication, and devotion and faith among his own people. But here's the point. Go back to Acts chapter 10. So you have these two centurions that approach Jesus via the Abrahamic covenant. Very clear here. The first centurion builds a synagogue. Isn't that blessing the nation of Israel? Remember the Abrahamic covenant? They that bless thee, I will bless. They that curse them, I'll curse them, right? So what Jesus does is, I'm not sent to these Gentiles, but you know what? Here's an exception. Here's a guy who is approaching Messiah as a Gentile who loves and blesses the nation of Israel. So what does Jesus do? I'm going to honor your request. And this is really fascinating. Jesus was ready to go to the guy's house. And you know what the centurion said? He says, no. Just say the word, my servant will be healed. And Jesus is like, man, this guy's, he's got it. And within that hour, the servant is healed. Well, Cornelius, he's got a reputation among the Jews. But with all of that said, go to chapter 11. Listen, you can give alms to the nation of Israel. You can give alms to the poor. You can pray. You can have a good report among the nation of Israel. You can fear God all you want. That is not a pattern for salvation unto eternal life. Isn't it interesting that in Acts chapter 11, look at what we read at verse 14. Verse 13, and he showed us how he had seen an angel in his house, which stood and said unto him, send men to Joppa and call for Simon, whose surname is Peter, who shall tell thee words whereby thou and all thy house shall be what? Saved. So that centurion, he wasn't a saved guy. He was just. He was a just man, gave alms. He feared God, had a great reputation and report among the nation of Israel. But he's not a pattern. Now, let me just say this. I know, go to 1 Timothy chapter 1. You know who our pattern is for salvation? 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Howbeit, for this cause I obtained mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show forth all longsuffering for a pattern to them which should hereafter believe on him to life everlasting. Do you want Cornelius to be your pattern? Or do you want this murderous, I'm over here, Acts 9. Do you want this murderous religious bigot, Saul of Tarsus, who was a blasphemer, who was unworthy, who was injurious, who was ignorant in unbelief? He was actually defiant against the will of God. He was persecuting that believing remnant. This guy, he was a scoundrel, wicked, opposed to what God is doing. And he says, you know what God did to me? I obtained mercy. Do you want a God who will save you because he's merciful, long-suffering, because he loves you? See, that's my pattern. Or do you want a Gentile who fears, gives money, has a good report, lives a just life? And you know what? He's still not a saved guy. He's not a pattern for anyone in the current dispensation of the grace of God. Now, we're going to have to stop. Go to Acts chapter 10. What is the gospel that Peter is referring to? What is the good news? What is the exciting, glad tidings that Peter is sent to communicate against his will, I might add? Remember, he has the vision. Peter, you go to this guy's house, and Peter says, I got a problem with this. This guy's a Gentile. It's as though Peter is saying to the Lord, don't you remember there's a wall of partition here? Don't you know they're the uncircumcision? I'm the circumcision. Don't you know that they're aliens and that these guys are strangers from the commonwealth of Israel? Don't you know, Lord, they don't have hope? They are without Christ. They're without God in this world. It's almost like he's baffled. Why is the Lord forcing him to violate the very wall of partition and ignore that wall of partition? So long story short, this is what happens when Peter receives the vision, the unclean animals, the clean animals, so on and so. You know what the good news is? Real quick, Acts chapter 10, verse 28. And he said unto them, ye know how that it is an unlawful thing for a man that is a Jew to keep company or come unto one of another nation. Now here's the good news. Here's the gospel that Peter is now going to communicate. But God has showed me that I should not call any man common or unclean. And then one more verse, drop down to verse 34. Then Peter opened his mouth and said, of a truth, I perceive. Now, Peter's going to perceive something else in Galatians 2. We're not going to go there. I perceive that God is no respecter of persons, but in every nation, he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him. You know what the good news is? Gentiles are no longer viewed as common or unclean. Isn't that good news? That's what Peter's talking about. And then Peter will continually learn. He learns that God is visiting there's a change that has taken place. And we're going to have to stop. But you read Galatians chapters 1 and 2. Those two chapters supply 16 proofs, a series of 16 proofs that what Paul was preaching was different than what Peter was preaching. Father, we do thank you for your grace. We do thank you for your love. We thank you, Lord, that in your mercy, love, and grace, and long-suffering, have chosen to initiate this glorious new program, this glorious new dispensation. We just thank you that for the last 2,000 years, you have chosen to be long-suffering. We pray, Lord, that we would be accurate when it comes to identifying the specific gospels that we are in possession of, and that we would faithfully communicate that information. We just thank you for the time that we can spend around your word, and as always, may it prove to be profitable to each of us, and we do ask in Christ Jesus' name. Amen.